أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله الطاهرين. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم، ولعنة الله على أعدائهم أجمعين إلى قيام يوم الدين. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك. عليكم مني جميعا سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت، وبقي الليل والنهار، ولا جعله الله آخر العهد مني لزيارتكم. السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين عليهم السلام. السلام عليك يا أبا صالح المهدي، عجل الله تعالى فرجه الشريف. My dearest brothers and sisters, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. Inshallah, tonight we'll continue and we'll build off of the introductory points that were made last night. And for those who were not present, I'll just quickly summarize the crux of the message that was hopefully presented, like I said, as an introduction. And tonight we'll move on to a few topics that perhaps are a little bit easier to digest, a little easier to relate to. I don't think that one topic is necessarily more difficult than the other. They may be a little new to us, and that's okay. I think the point of coming to Majlis and the point of coming to an Islamic center is, of course, to educate ourselves and to engage with things that not only we know, but also give some depth to the things that we're familiar with. So we find ourselves relating with, hearing, and hopefully engaging with things that are a little unfamiliar to us. I think that should be welcome, and that should be received as a challenge. Because if we always hear the things that we're accustomed to hearing, that's good to remind, to solidify, to emphasize, to reflect. But what happens if it's only confined to that, and we're not afforded the opportunity to explore a world and a heritage that is truly infinite in depth? And because we are connected with Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad, because we are connected to a heritage that is so rich, we should allow ourselves the opportunity to engage with as many facets of that culture as we potentially can. So last night what we discussed was, we tried to revisit the idea of the significance of the day of Arba'in, and specifically the Ziyarah of Arba'in. We spoke about the first Arba'in that was performed, whether it was with the caravan of the Ahlul Bayt returning, or whether it was exclusive to the visit of the great companion of the Holy Prophet and the Imams, Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari. In any case, we said that because of the knowledge, the relationship, the friendship that he had with the Imam, that drove him to, even at his old age, we said Jabir lived to 100 years old, and the time that he went to do Ziyarah, he was blind. Not only was there not the established Zari and the shrine, but you know, no grave was even defined there. So Jabir going there, a blind man, you might ask yourself, well, what is there to see? But the love that is there really drives a person to do that. So in our reading of Ziyarat al-Arba'in that we all read yesterday or the day before, like we said, it's a short Ziyarah, but there are a lot of very important points there and very profound points and statements that we make, proclamations that we make. So we mentioned a few of them, and I'll just mention them today because we're going to build off of them. One of them was this: Allahumma inni ushiduka anni waliyun liman bala wa aduun liman ada. Oh Allah, I take you to be my witness that surely I have befriended those who are friends to you, and I have made enemies of those who are enemies with you. So not only the enemies of the Imam, but also they are the enemies of Allah. Bi abi anta wa ummi ya ibn Rasulullah. My mother and my father be given to you, that means may they be at your disposal. So this is the highest state that a person can allow their resources for a cause. Then we made this statement, which I found to be a lot more difficult for a person to actually, you know, enunciate something like this if they're paying attention to what they're actually saying. Wa ashhadu anni bikum mu'min. I bear witness that I am a believer of yours. That means I believe in your message, I believe in your cause. وَبِإِيَابِكُمْ مُوقِنْ. And in your return, I also have yaqeen, certainty. So this can touch on a number of different things, whether it's touching on the idea of raja'at, It means the return of the Ahlul Bayt, the Imams, that's one point. Or whether it's the coming of one Imam after another. So imagine now in the context of our time, this is being recited to an Imam that was present, and in the time of the presence of another Imam. So we said the Ziyarat al-Arba'in was taught when? Who remembers from who was here last night? Or if you know generally, which Imam taught us this Ziyarah? Imam Ja'far Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam. So the sixth Imam is teaching us Ziyarat al-Arba'in. So until the time of the Holy Imam of our time, every Imam is now present. What about our time? Our Imam is not present the way that other Imams were. So I also have certainty in your return. بِشَرَايِعِ دِينِ وَخَوَاتِيمَ عَمَلِي I have certainty in the teachings of my religion and also in the seal of my actions. Not only am I certain on a conceptual level of what it is that is expected of me as far as my religious teachings go and the religious tenets go, but also I'm so certain in my own conduct. Well, this is a grand statement for a person to make. Many of us feel uncomfortable with the level and the quality of our conduct. I, for one, of course do. Which of us can actually sit here and say that, you know, Allah, God, I think I'm a good Muslim. Not only do I think I'm a good Muslim, I think I'm the best Muslim. And I'm so certain in that I take you as my witness. Very few of us. It's not that we don't want to. So the point here is this. If we're making statements like this, are they hyperbolic? That means, are we exaggerating? Are we meant to exaggerate? Or are we saying something that's untrue? Are we lying? Someone may look to our tradition and say, what do you guys read? 40th day, your Imam is, okay, let me read this. Whoa, you guys believe this? If I look to the conduct of your community, I don't see everyone like this. So why are you guys saying things like this? It seems almost hypocritical. Shouldn't be saying stuff like that. That's a question. We have to ask ourselves, and if others ask us, we have to be able to respond. And the final reflection point is perhaps this is not a statement of a fact that exists right now in reality, but an ideal that we are striving towards achieving. And that's a different point. It's like, Allah, I am making this promise that my practice and my understanding of my religion will be to a point, one day, in one instant, in the highest point of my lived life, that I will be like this. I will be so certain in your teaching, and I will be so certain in my action. These are all completely different things. They're different perspectives, but each of them play a different role in our personal development. This should not be lost on us. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. So this was the introduction that we recited from Ziyarat al-Arba'in. وَقَلْبِي لِقَلْبِكُمْ سِلْمٌ وَأَمْرِي لِأَمْرِكُمْ مُتَّبِعٌ My heart is at peace with you. My actions are based on your commands. وَنُصْرِتِي لَكُمْ مُعِدَّ My support is ready for you. حَتَّى يَأْذَنَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ فَمَعَكُمْ مَعَكُمْ لَا مَعَدُوكُمْ So I'm with you, I'm not with your enemies. So, a few quick points to make about the ziyarah that is performed. If you remember yesterday we spoke about ziyarah is not just about being in close proximity to an imam or to their grave. It's not. It's about connecting with an imam. It's about connecting with their reality, their soul, their ideal. So that can be done from afar. We're instructed to do it from afar. None of us are at Karbala right now, but we performed the Ziyarah of Arba'in. We believe that. Of course we did. But there are certain etiquettes now. When a person is speaking like this, they're coming in the presence of the imam, there are etiquettes that have to be there. Look, any sort of respected, divine, venerated article that we engage with, there's a certain respect that has to follow with it. We come to the majlis, correct? No person will allow themselves to come to the majlis dressed inappropriately. An elder will always tell them, you know, young man, young woman, you seem to be dressed, but not for this venue. You know, there's a certain dress code here. We're not judging, we're just saying you seem out of place. If you come in the majlis and you start laying down, you know, it's abnormal. You know, why are you doing it? Did someone not teach you? Well, to help them. In the recitation and engagement with the Qur'an, there has to be a certain way we sit, a certain way we hold the Qur'an. What if we hold the Qur'an, we stretch our feet? What if we hold the Qur'an, we're laying down, holding like we read a novel? Is that respectful or disrespectful? But we see it from time to time, correct? So the ziyarah is also the same way. You're putting yourself in the presence of the imam and you're making statements like this. So there has to be a certain etiquette. In hadith, because sometimes, not because we have bad intentions, we forget. Imagine the ziyarah that's happening in Arba'een, just passed a few days ago. Millions of people have gone. And the numbers will continue to increase. This year we didn't have the blessing to go. Inshallah, next year, all of us together. When we do go sometimes, if we don't constantly remind ourselves of what we're doing, the main point that defines the reason for this journey is sometimes lost. And that it shows itself in our conduct. So I want to draw a parallel between sometimes the way we or others perform ziyarah and the way we or others sometimes perform other forms of ziyarah, like the hajj. So I'm going to share two hadith from the imams that speak about this. Both of them are from Imam Sadiq alayhi salatu wasalam, and the language is pretty harsh. Again, he's trying to teach us. The first one. عن أبي عبد الله عليه الصلاة والسلام قال إذا زرت أبا عبد الله عليه الصلاة والسلام فزره وأنت حزين مكروب شعث مغير جائع عطشان. If you're going to go to the ziyarah of Imam Hussein, make sure that you prepare yourself mentally and physically before you go. If you're going there, try your best to resemble the state of the imam you're going to meet. If your imam was martyred, thirsty, try your best to meet your imam thirsty as well. Because you're his companion, you're his follower, you're in his army, you're in his rank. Imagine of the soldiers of the imam, everyone is thirsty, then one person goes and drinks water. It seems uncharacteristic. None of them would allow themselves even the thought of that. Abbas alayhi salatu wasalam, when he goes to the Furat to bring water for the children, he has opportunity. Why not drink? People say, well, why didn't he drink? He would have had more energy and more power and strength. He would have fought and killed more people. It's a principle that's important here. So when we go for ziyarah, we have to try and resemble that as well. فَإِنَّ الْحُسَيْنَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ قُتِلَ حَزِينًا مَكْرُوبًا شَعِثًا مُغَيِّرًا جَائِعًا عَطْشَاءً وَاسْأَلُوا الْحَوَاجَ وَانْصَرِفْ عَنْهُ وَلَا تَتَّخَذُهُ وَتَنَا. Go there, resemble that, make the ziyarah, quickly return. Ask for your needs, quickly leave. Don't make that your watan. Don't make that your home. The first hadith. The second hadith is now the imam speaking of some of the things that he's heard. Sometimes the imams, they're connected with what's happening in the society. Many of us may think that, the imam is kind of in his own corner with his own crew and with his own clan. Even now, it may seem that, there's so many different factions. People don't really know what's happening in other people's circles. That may be true, but the imam is not like that. The imam will never be oblivious to what's happening. Even in a time like this, you say, where's my imam? I don't know where he is. He is still not oblivious to what's happening in our circles. Absolutely not. So the imam now to one of the companions addresses him like this. قال أبو عبد الله عليه الصلاة والسلام بلغني. It has come to my attention. أن قوما إذا زاروا الحسين عليه الصلاة والسلام حملوا معهم الصفرة فيها الجداء والأخبصة والأشباه. It's come to my attention that some of you or some people that go to the ziyarah of my grandfather Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, you go, you make the ziyarah, but with you, you take these sufra. Sufra is what? Sufra, that's dastarkhan. What we place under us to eat. Ma'ida, sometimes we say. It's like you're taking picnic baskets with you. It's fine, you have to eat. But within that are delicious foods, are sweets that you take with yourselves. Imam says that, وَلَوْ زَارُوا قُبُورَ أَحِبَّائِهِمْ مَا حَمَلُوا مَعُوا مَعُوا. If they were going to visit the graves of their beloveds, they wouldn't go like this. They don't take it as if they're going to a picnic. Again, the point is not to eat. No, the point is, what is the person's approach? What is the person's, intention in how they're trying to interact with this experience of ziyarah? We said, Jabir ibn Abdullah, that was the experience that he had. When he comes to the grave of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, he cries so much, profusely, until he passes out. They have to pour water on his face to wake him up. Now you may say, okay, well, I'm only 8, 9, 10, 11 years old. I've gone ziyarah, but I didn't cry so much that I passed out. Does that make me a bad person? No. But as all of us know, when we go for ziyarah, the first thing you have to request permission to enter. When you request permission from your imam, they say, what is the sign that the imam has accepted your permission to enter? That the tear comes to your eye, right? That's when you know that you've made a connection heart to heart. Because the point is not to just put your head down and go and say, I'm here, I've come, I read, these are my needs, and I've gone. No, it's not about that. It's about a connection of the hearts. وَقَلْبِي لِقَلْبِكُمْ سِلْ. My heart is at peace with you. Not that I brought my wish list to you and you've, you know, responded to, you know, we don't have, sometimes, you know, the way that religious concepts or, you know, ideas like this are presented in popular culture, God forbid, it's a bad comparison. But just for to make a point, we don't treat our imams like, God forbid, like Santa Claus. That we're going, you know, for this year, for this Christmas, for this Eid, you know, I want this, and that. Make a list, and then like he's just going to get our list somehow, and he's going to give us the presents. The imam will give you whatever you want. In hadith says, even the salt that you pour on your food, ask the imams for them. But the method that you present yourself is extremely important. The imams will give whether you're respectful or disrespectful. The point is a person's, the pride and honor that a person has. To show the imam, to come to the presence of the imam, humble. And a person who has been trained and raised correctly. It's a sign of a person's training and upbringing. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. This was a small point that we made in regards to the etiquette of ziyarah. The etiquette is extended to any ziyarah we do, the hajj as well. Now, we don't have time and I don't want to speak about this too much because it's not the main point of my talk, but there's a lot to be said here of the little that we've observed and what we hear. It's fine. You're not... وَيْلٌ لِلْمُطَفِّفِينَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا اكْتَالُوا عَلَى النَّاسِ يَسْتَوْفُونَ. We're not saying that you should pay for something and the services not be presented to you, services not be rendered. That's not the point. If you paid for a 5-star hotel, okay, they should put you in a 5-star hotel. If you paid for a 5-course meal, it's their responsibility to serve you 5 courses. But if you go to Hajj, and it's in the middle of your a'mal, and you get up for breakfast, and there's only 4 courses, if you lose your mind and can't concentrate during the tawaf because I paid for 5, they gave me 4, they're cheating me, وَيْلُوا لِلْمُتَفِفِينَ, you've lost the point. This trip has been wasted. So the arifan bihaqqikum that we spoke about last night, when that's not established, then the result of a trip like that will not be a person as if they've been born anew. Let's be honest with ourselves. We're not talking about the lawh, the book that is in the presence of Allah and He puts our deeds. Let's put that aside for a second. Put that aside. Let's imagine that there are no scores. There are no grades. Imagine Allah's not going to say, this is your book, you did good, you did bad, heaven, hell. Let's just imagine, Allah says, you decide for yourself. Okay? In the observation that we have of ourselves, not of other people, when we go to the Hajj and perform the Hajj, do we feel like when we return, we've been born anew? Again, we're not saying yes or no. The point is, this needs to be the main point of reflection when a person goes and comes. Has this been accomplished or not? So that was a tangent in the ziyarah. Again, there's a lot to reflect on. I think nights like these provides good opportunity for us to do that. Now, in the ziyarah of Arba'een, towards the earlier stages, again, we said it's not a long ziyarah. We speak about the imam instructs us of what the main objective of the imam was. Many of us have read this. We continue to read this. I'm just going to highlight it to transition to the main point of tonight. In the ziyarah, we read, فَأَعْذَرَ فِي الدُّعَاءِ وَمَنَحَ النُّصْحَ وَبَذَلَ مُهْجَتَهُ فِيكْ لِيَسْتَنْقِذَ عِبَادَكَ مِنَ الْجَهَالَةِ وَحِيرَةِ الظَّلَالَةِ. O my Imam, you were met with deadly dangers. You acted justly, you acted fairly, you used everything in your possession to pay full attention and to present sincere advice. You took the pains, you made every effort, you put your mind, your soul, your body, your life at the disposal of your mission, which it can be defined and summarized as this, that you not only attempted but succeeded to liberate the people from the yoke of ignorance and from the evil of bewilderment. This was your objective and this was your accomplishment. You acted in the role that is being an imam. You were an educator to the people. You were a guide to the people. You were a teacher to the people. And you took a scene like Karbala to be your classroom. And we study that and we learn from it. Now, if the imam plays the role of an educator, again, to have personal reflection, inward reflection, I am now a student, a pupil, for many years, even if I'm younger, from the youngest person in this crowd, I can assure you it's not their first year being here, even the babies. They've been here before, so they're students as well. For however many years that I've been here in this majalis, I'm a student. What do I have as a student to show as an accomplishment of what I have learned conceptually, what I have been able to establish practically, realistically in myself? This is the question that needs to be asked. Because the role of the educator, we can't question of, you know, how well did he do? Let's have a kind of an assessment of how well the imam did. No, here, this answer is clear to us. We don't need to spend time on that. But the question that needs to be asked for each and every one of us, individually first, then as a community, what has been the result of that? We said last night, the 40 days, this cycle is done. Most of the majalis slowly, for sure the frequency will not be the same as this 40 days. Almost every night we have majalis. But after the arba'een, slowly, it's done. What was the result of this cycle? What can I say that was accomplished this year? In this class that I went of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, his companions of Karbala, arba'een. So, the question that perhaps would allow us to better understand that is that, okay, why did the imam do what he did? And why did he do it the way that he did it? And you say, okay, well, he's the imam. He has to do it. You know, Allah chose him, said, this is your job, and you're best suited for this job. Well, you have to take on this responsibility, and he did gladly. Okay, well, this is a very simplistic answer. It's not wrong, it's correct, but it's simplistic. It's just like looking at prophecy and saying, well, why did the prophets do what they did? Well, you know, there were good people, and then one day, all of a sudden, they were inspired. They saw something, you know, they had a dream, they had a vision, and then Allah communicated with them and told them, you know, this is your responsibility, this is your mission now. And they accepted. Again, it's not wrong, but there's simplistic ways of looking at very complex and very detailed ideas. So if imam plays the role of educator, and he sacrifices himself as an educator, a true educator does, and a teacher does, what was the base of that? And the base of that can be nothing but the love that Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, his companions, and all of the Ahlul Bayt have towards their followers, their Shia. It's the love that they have that drives them to do these things. Yes, they are imam, yes, they are responsible, but let's look at it outside of the scope of a person who is their responsibility. You know, they're in charge, they are the boss. No. We're not workers. We are lovers, and they are our beloveds, and that's why they interact with us the way that they did. So tonight what I want to do is I want to speak very briefly about this idea of brotherhood, friendship, love that we have in the tradition of Islam, in the tradition of the Ahlul Bayt, and specifically to bring a few examples of how that was realized during this journey of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam. Salawat ala Muhammad wa Ali Muhammad. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala states in Surah Ali Imran, verse 31. Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. قُلْ إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ فَاتَّبِعُونِي يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ وَيَغْفِرْ لَكُمْ ذُنُوبَكُمْ وَاللَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. The Holy Prophet is instructed to say this. إِن كُنْتُمْ تُحِبُّونَ اللَّهِ. If you truly have love for Allah, فَاتَّبِعُونِي, then follow me. The result of this action, يُحْبِبْكُمُ اللَّهِ. Then Allah will love you. Now, if a person wants to love, the relationship only makes sense if it's both ways. If one side loves, the other side doesn't love, it's a sign of not a normal relationship. It either doesn't exist or it's dysfunctional. It's unhealthy. It's abusive almost. So the messenger is telling the people, that's the ultimate goal you have, to love God to please him, to make him happy, then follow me and my command, and follow my path and my instruction. That will result in God loving you. Now, what does the Imam do in trying to help us understand what this love is? The Imam says that I'm going to teach you in my life, and all of my fathers and all of my progeny will teach you as well, that the love that you have, the truest love that a person can have is only the love with their Lord. Every other love that they have is fine, but they're all smaller. They're all smaller experiences of what that true love is. Okay? The friendships that we all have, they're good. They all serve purposes. But many of them will be short-lived. There will only be one kind of friendship that will stand the test of time and stand the test of eternity. The Holy Quran says, "Al-akhillah yawma idhin ba'duhum li ba'din adu." The khalil, khalil means the brothers of one another. On this day, ba'duhum li ba'din, some of them for others shall become enemies. Illa al-muttaqin. With exception to only the muttaqin, the people who have truly understood the idea of what it means to be to have taqwa. So to have taqwa is to follow in suit of a person who is also muttaqi. So when we call our imams Imamul Muttaqin, they're the leader of people who will remain as one body and will remain as one caravan even during the day that all people are looking to run away from one another and they're finding fault with one another. In hadith we have this, people who befriend one another outside of the scope which is defined by taqwa. They're friends, then one of them dies. When one of them dies, they begin to experience the realities of after death. So they ask him, this is what your outcome of your life is, and this is probably where you're going to go. So they show him that whatever his place is in hell. The person becomes, you know, a little surprised and they get scared. And they start making excuses like many people do. They don't want to take responsibility for their actions. They say, you know what, it wasn't my fault. I did these things, but you know, bad influences. So if you want to find fault in anybody, you want to, you know, you want to charge anybody, it's my friend that did that. And each of them will kind of do this to one another. They're running away from one another. They can't stand to be with one another except the muttaqin. So the caravan of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, what makes it so unique is that, notice, the caravan began and they continued step after step after step after step with one another. Few people did join. But once a person comes in, the love here, the bond here is so strong that unless a person really, there's something essentially and existentially wrong with them, there's no chance for them to exit this community, this caravan. This caravan was intact from the day that it started to the day that it returned to Medina. This is the profound effect that the caravan of Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam had. So we are trying to join in that caravan. We're not trying to go ourselves, we're trying to join that so we may be connected with this bond. So the taqwa is really what's being looked for in how we can define our friendship. What I want to do in the time that we have, essentially we're going to survey some hadith. I think there's nothing more blessed that we can do in our majalis is to study the verses of the Quran and the ahadith. Like we said last night, there's so much of hadith that really has been left unexplored. You may say, well, a lot of it's unauthentic. Okay, hold on. After a person has attempted to authenticate, only then should they be making statements like this. In any case, I'm going to share a few hadith from different imams that speak about what true friendship is within Islam. And the reason why I chose this here is that how are we supposed to contrast that to the friendships we do or we don't have right now in our lives? It is a very unclear, murky sort of topic. The idea of friendship, I think, in many senses, is not very well defined in our lives. Who can we even call a friend? What constitutes friendship? What is the difference between that and acquaintances? What is the difference between that and people I just associate with? In any case, I'll begin with a rawayah from Imam Al-Askari alayhi salatu wassalam, in which he states, from the Holy Prophet, قَالَ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمْ لِبَعْدِ أَصْحَابِهِ ذَاتَ يَوْمٍ. The Holy Prophet was addressing a number of his companions on a day. Ya Abdallah, O servants of Allah, Ahbib fillah, wa abghid fillah, wa wal fillah, وَعَادْ فِي اللَّهِ. O servants of Allah, love for the sake of Allah, hate for the sake of Allah, befriend for the sake of Allah, shun people, make enemies, distance yourself from people for the sake of Allah. فَإِنَّهُ لَا تُنَالُ وِلَايَةُ اللَّهِ إِلَّا بِذَلِكَ. Know for sure that the wilaya, even if we want to translate that as the friendship of Allah will not be established until a person has that sort of a mentality and approach. وَلَا يَجِدُ الرَّجُلُ تَعْمَ الْإِيمَانِ. No man or woman shall taste the flavor of iman. وَإِنْ كَثُرَتْ صَلَاتُهُ وَسِيَامُهُ حَتَّى يَكُونُ كَذَلِكَ. Even if their prayers are extended and extensive, even if their fasting is day after day and after day and it never stops, if a person doesn't have these four things, they will never taste the flavor of iman. وَقَدْ صَارَتْ مُؤَاخَاتُ النَّاسِ يَوْمَكُمْ هَذَا أَكْثَرُهَا فِي الدُّنْيَا. Today, it's an assessment that the Prophet's making. In my day, I can see that most people befriend each other. Something it has to do with this life, this world, worldly affairs. عَلَيْهَا يَتَوَادُّونَ وَعَلَيْهَا يَتَبَاغَذُونَ وَذَلِكَ لَا يُغْنِي عَنْهُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ شَيْئًا. They befriend each other for whatever, you know, cooperation or goals they have in this worldly life. They make enemies with one another. They hate one another because of something that relates to the worldly affairs. This kind of relationship has no value in the eyes of Allah. فَقَالَ الرَّجُلُ. A man then asked, يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ فَكَيْفَ لِي أَنْ أَعْلَمَ أَنِّي قَدْ وَالَيْتُ وَعَادَيْتُ فِي اللَّهِ. Always there was companions there to ask his questions. Okay, I want to choose friends. Who am I supposed to befriend? How do I know the person that I'm considering to befriend, not the person that I'm already friends with, the person I'm considering their friendship with, how do I know that my friendship with them is out of the love of Allah and for the sake of Allah? And how do I know when I distance myself from another person that it's for the sake of Allah? Now listen, it's an important point here. Why? Because there are people that we get along with, our friends. There are people that we are not really that close with. They're not enemies to us, but they're also not friends. They're people we just know. Then there are people we dislike, and then there are people we hate. All of us have these. There are very few who say, I love everybody. Many of us say that, but in reality, when a certain name comes up, you can see that the facial expression changes. You can find that there's multiple doors for a person to exit from. They quickly find the nearest exit, and they leave when they see that person. So we have all of these. So this companion is asking, how do I know? So he's asking for a formula, a principle that each and every one of us should look to this. Now the answer is going to be, many may think it's simplistic, well, you know, this is a platitude. We already know these things, but it's important to read into it correctly. وَمَنْ وَلِيُّ اللَّهِ عَزَّ وَجَلْ حَتَّى أُوَالِيهُ وَمَنْ عَدُوهُ حَتَّى أُعَادِيهُ. How do I know a person has this qualification? The Prophet فَأَشَارَ لَهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَآلِهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِلَىٰ عَلِيٍّ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامِ. The Prophet then pointed to Amir al-Mu'mineen alayhi salatu wasalam, and he told that man, فَقَالَ أَتَرَى هَذَا. You see him? قَالَ بَلَى. Yes. قَالَ وَلِيُّ هَذَا وَلِيُّ اللَّهِ. The friend of this person is befriended for the sake of Allah and is the friend of Allah. فَوَالِهِ. So make friends with him. وَعَدُوُّ هَذَا عَدُوُّ اللَّهِ. And the enemy of this person is the enemy of Allah. And he has made enemies with them for Allah. فَعَادِهِ. So shun them as well and make enemies with them. وَوَالِ وَلِيَّ هَذَا وَلَوْ أَنَّهُ قَاتِلُ أَبِيكَ وَوَلَدِكَ. And remain steadfast in your friendship with him, even if he were to kill your father and your child. وَعَادِ عَدُوَّ هَذَا وَلَوْ أَنَّهُ أَبُوكَ وَوَلَدُكَ. And remain firm in keeping enemies with his enemies, even if it was your father or your child. They say, well, we know these things. We follow in the footsteps of our Ahlul Bayt, of course. It's a very simplistic answer the Prophet gave, but he's showing them the continuation of how a person is supposed to conduct themselves. It's not about just take example. This is a profound statement, and it's an absolute statement. It's not a statement that was later abrogated. We may say, well, the Prophet was kind of speaking well about all of the companions. So this person's good, you know, kind of look to him, look to him. We may have said a lot of things about many companions. But the prophet is very careful in the choice of words. He doesn't make statements like this about any person. So whatever is defined in the tradition of the Ahlul Bayt as who a person should befriend and for what reason, and who a person should take as their enemies and shun, and for what reason, that should become the standard by which every follower in Shia, there's no other way around this word. Either we stop using the word Shia. Shia means the person who follows. Imagine step by step, imagine when it snows soon, the first person who takes the step in the snow and leaves their footprint there, that's the Imam. Every Shia after that, they're not walking in the same direction. Each and every person is walking in the same footstep of the Imam. There should be one track only. We forget this sometimes. We say, what was the general direction? And I'm going to move in that general. What was the main principle of Karbala? Just, you know, water it down for me. Stand up against evil, correct? Stand up against injustice, correct? Yes. But not that each one of us take our own paths to that. There's one distinct defined path. And only when a person comes to this realization that a person will achieve the Husseini standards and the Husseini accomplishments and victories, when they begin to put their feet in the footsteps of not only Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, but every Imam that followed, especially and specifically the Imam of our time, which is still making footprints today, but the problem is these footprints are lost. These footprints are not clear and evident to us. We're looking at the plane, we see that the snow is untouched, but the Imam is walking there. And the more a person is able to approximate themselves to this tradition, then the Imams will begin to open a person's eyes. One of the companions once said, one day I came to the presence of Imam Qadhim alayhi salatu wasalam. دخلتُ على أبي الحسن موسى بن جعفر عليه الصلاة والسلام وعنده محمد بن عبد الله الجعفري. I came to the presence of Imam al-Qadhim عليه الصلاة والسلام, and another companion was there of his, محمد بن عبد الله الجعفري. فتبسمت إليه. So I smiled at him. It's Muhammad. The Imam said, فقال عليه السلام أتحبه? Do you like him? فقلت نعم, yes. وما أحببته إلا لكم. But the reason I like him, there's no other reason that I like him except for the love that I have for you. فَقَالَ عَلَيْهِ السَّلَامُ وَأَخُكُ. He's your brother. وَالْمُؤْمِنُ أَخُ الْمُؤْمِنِ لِأَبِيهِ وَأُمِّهِ. A believer is a brother to another believer, a paternal and a maternal brother, and a maternal or paternal sister. We think we have paternal and maternal brothers and sisters, you know, blood brothers, blood sisters, that's one. It's the closer one. Then we have believing brothers, believing sisters. They're also brothers and sisters, but you know, they're not as close as our rahim, you know, as our blood brothers. Imam is saying that no. If anything, these people are equal to them. And then Imam continues, mal'unun, mal'unun, the curse of Allah, the curse of Allah. Man ittahama akhahu, a person who accuses his brother and slanders his brother. Mal'unun, mal'unun, man ghasha akhahu. The wrath of Allah cursed upon the person who tries and cheat his brother. مَلْعُونٌ مَلْعُونٌ مَنْ لَمْ يَنْسَحْ أَخَاهُ. Cursed beyond this person, cursed beyond this person, an individual who doesn't admonish his brother. مَلْعُونٌ مَلْعُونٌ مَنْ اسْتَأْثَرَ عَلَىٰ أَخِيهِ. Cursed is he, cursed is who makes something exclusive to himself and doesn't want to share with his brother. مَلْعُونٌ مَلْعُونٌ مَنْ احْتَجَبَ عَنْ أَخِيهِ. Cursed be that person who makes himself unavailable to his brother. مَلْعُونٌ مَلْعُونٌ مَنْ اِخْتَابَ أَخَاهُ. And cursed be on the person who backbites behind his brother's back. So, how are we trying to draw inspiration from the love and the friendship that the Imam portrayed to us and his companions in? Now, they say, okay, brothers, you know, we're all brothers. I can't have the same relationship that I have with the Imam with other people. The point is, if we're all within the network of belief, is there going to now be classism within even this religious divine concept that we create classes? There's a hierarchy now that we treat some brothers better than the other ones? You say, okay, well, there are of course stages of Iman, yes. But do the Imams instruct us to discriminate against brothers and sisters in belief? No. Can I backbite against some of my brothers and not backbite against others because one is bad and one is good? No. The point that the Imam is trying to make here, and I'll end with two stories. The Imam is trying to say that if you believe truly, if you have love for Allah, if you have love for the Imam, you should love for your brother what you love for yourself, number one. Number two is that of all of the things, there's so many rights, and I have hadith here, we don't have time to go through. Maybe tomorrow night we'll survey some of them. Of all of the rights that we have, that this the mu'min has this right on his brother, this right, countless number of hadith. If you open Al-Kafi, there's so much there. In Kitab Iman wal-Kufr, read them. One after another. Risalatul Huwul from Zainul Abidin alayhi salatu wasalam says, this is how you should conduct yourself. But of all of the things that said, the money, financial help, not to backbite, not to slander, not to cheat, all of those correct, which we struggle with. We find a brother to cheat them. Why? Because they trust us. Even from my own experiences, I shouldn't say this, I won't say this. In any case, of all of the rights that there is, there's one right that's often neglected, and that's the religious right, the emotional right, the spiritual right, the mental right of a brother and sister that they have on one another. That means as much as you care of the financial situation of your brother and sister, which we should also care the mental state, the emotional state, and the religious and spiritual state of an individual as well. The Imam is saying that curse be onto that person, curse be onto that person that does not admonish his brother, does not care for the well-being spiritually, religiously of his brother and sister. Can see that they need help, but don't take it upon themselves to do anything. And the excuse that is brought is that it's none of my business. If it's none of your business to care about his spiritual health, then why is it any of your business to care how much money is in his pocket or in his bank account? One of the companions came to the Imam and said, you know, like, we're strong in number. Many times throughout history, good-hearted people, simple people, in some senses, naive people. They're not bad. They're going to be taught. They come and say, you know, we're ready. We have numbers. Look, if someone right now happens to run into the Imam of our time, Allah hasten his reappearance, just happened to run into him and says, you know what? Arba'in this year, 20 million people were there. 20 million people. If you were to come by the grace of Allah and make an announcement that I'm here, 20 million will turn into 100 million people. Half a billion people will come. That's not enough? People came to the Imam and said, we have forces. Let's implement what has been God's will. The Imam says, let me ask you a few questions. Your brothers, correct? Says, yes. Says, is it your brotherhood to the extent that one brother can put his hand in the pocket of the other brother, take money, and the other brother not say anything and not feel, not get upset, not even feel like anything abnormal has been done? The man thought, he said, no, I don't observe this sort of etiquette and behavior within the people that I know. He says, we're not ready. Brother, what are you saying? Are you saying that we should post our account numbers here? Or everyone's money should go in the big pool of Gharad al-Hasana? And then, you know, everyone should be honest and, you know, on, you know, this merit of honesty, everyone, whoever needs however much, you know, come and take this, a very, you know, socialist system, and then everyone hopefully is honest. Essentially, yes. The trust, the love has to be that strong. If you're going to trust your life in the hands of another person, if you're going to trust the safety and security of your family and loved ones to another brother in faith, then who cares about the money? So they come to the Imams and they say these things. The Imam says, we're not there yet. You have to love and care for a brother as you care for yourself. So as much as you care for your own akhirah, care for the akhirah of your brother and sister. And be a mentor, be a guide, be a support for them as well. So there needs to be an educational revolution. If anything we learn from Karbala, it's an educational revolution. It was reform. It was educational reform. Now, educational reform how? In the country? I don't care. There needs to at least be educational reform within
this tightly knit group, this caravan of the Shia, there needs to be educational reform. What does that mean? Does that mean we don't have the knowledge, we don't have the books, we have to... No, it's all there. There needs to be a return to the culture and the identity of what it means truly to follow in the teachings of our imams. That has been abandoned. If I think to myself, you say, there's so much hadith, if I spend a lifetime just reading, I'll never get through the whole thing. Bihar al-Anwar, like we said last night from Allama Majesty, 110 volumes. Let's say that's the only book I read. If a 110 volume book I'm reading it in Arabic and I don't even understand, so I have to get a translator or someone has to read it with me, imagine. 110 volumes. Maybe a person like me will not even get through the Quran once in my whole lifetime because I only read selected surahs or verses. How am I going to get through 110 volumes of a book of hadith? Some of them are authentic and inauthentic. But the question someone like me should ask myself to shut myself up and to bring myself back to a state of clarity is that, what would you say that your imam spoke words for you and your guidance and you were indifferent to them? So the educational reform needs to come, and it needs to come out of a point of love. And the two stories that I promised to share with you, with the salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. I'll preface that with a riwayah found in Al-Kafi. It's a long riwayah from Imam Radha alayhi salatu wasalam. He speaks about the imam, the characteristics of the imam, fi sifat al-imam, very beautiful. Remember last year in one of my classes we were reading this. We spent a few days just to go through the hadith. It's so heavy, you know, it's so profound what's being said. A person really has to read and come back. This is one portion of it, and I feel like this really is manifested in the interactions that Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wasalam had to almost every person. He says, Al-Imamu, and continues, Al-Imamu Anisur Rafiq. The Imam is a comforting friend. Al-Walidu Shafiq. The Imam is a kind, a very kind father. Wal-Akhu Shaqiq. And the Imam is like a real brother. Wal-Ummu Al-Barratu Bil-Walad Al-Saghir. And the Imam is like a kind mother to her small child. وَمَفْزَعُ الْعِبَادِ فِي الدَّهَاهِيَةِ النَّادِ. And he is a refuge for people in disastrous conditions. This is the mindset and the attitude of the Imam when he looks at each and every individual, when he's looking to us right now, the Imam of our time. Like a loving and caring mother and father, a brother. The first story is an individual that the Imam encounters with in the different stations, you know, when the Imam is now traveling from Mecca to Karbala, there are different stations that the Imam stops. And different things happen at these different stations, manazil. One of these manazil towards the end, closer when they get to Karbala, is a station by the name of Qasr Bani Muqatil, the castle of Bani Muqatil. This was an area close to Qutqutana. Qutqutana was the last station that the Imam stopped before stopping at Nainawa. So very close now, towards the end of the Imam's final stops. He stops at the place of Qasr of Bani Muqatil. There was a castle there that belonged to someone by the name of Muqatil ibn Hassan. They named that place Qasr Bani Muqatil. Okay. There was a tent that was erected there. The Imam asks, whose tent is this? The companions inquire and they return that this is the tent of a person by the name of Ubaydullah ibn Hur al-Ju'fi. Ubaydullah, not again, his story is a little longer, he had an interesting life, but in any case, he was a friend and supporter of the third Khalifa. After the death of the third Khalifa, he leaves Kufa, and he goes and joins Muawiyah's forces, Ali La'na, in Damascus. And he fights in Muawiyah's army in the battle of Siffin against Amir al-Mu'mineen, alayhi salatu wasalam. And after the martyrdom of Amir al-Mu'mineen, alayhi salatu wasalam, he returns to Kufa. And he's regarded to be the brave and the lead of Kufa. In any case, he's here in this manzil of Qasr bin Muqatil. The Imam sends a messenger by the name of Hajjaj ibn Masruq to the tent and he invites him to come and meet the Imam. Like many other people, the Imam sends a messenger and invites them. Ubaydullah responds like this, Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. By Allah, I left Kufa after observing that the majority of people were preparing for battle with Hussein alayhi salam and his supporters, and I am certain that he and his companions were going to be killed in this altercation. And since I didn't have the means or the resources to assist him in his victory, I left the city. وَاللَّهُ This is Arabic. وَاللَّهُ مَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ أَرَاهُ وَلَا يَرَانِي By Allah, neither did I want to see Hussein, neither did I want him to see me. That means the condition is so tense that he doesn't even want to be seen. Okay. Hajjaj now returns to the Imam and says, this is how he responded. Imam puts his shoes on and goes to the tent of Ubaydullah. Now, Imam could have easily said, okay, I sent a messenger. The Imam requested, at least the etiquette is to come and see what the Imam has to say. This person has already made his mind up. I came here specifically not to see the Imam, because I know what was going to happen. Imam says, I'm going to go. Look, Imam loves, cares. He's not going to give up and say, you know, I offered the opportunity. He said, no, I'm going to go and sure, make sure this person knows the decision that they're making. Ubaydullah responds when the Imam comes and you know, encourages him to join the movement. Ubaydullah responds like this, by Allah, I know that whoever follows your lead will result in their martyrdom, and it will also result in their eternal salvation, their bliss. I know that. However, I doubt that the support that I'm going to give you is going to change anything of the outcome. The people that I saw in Kufa, I don't see any of them changing their position to come in support of you. So, with that analysis, I'm coming from Kufa right now, I ask you, pardon me, exempt me from this. I'm not ready to die now. So, he's not trying to say that, he's saying, whatever you want to do, do it, but this is my analysis, this is my assessment. I think this is a lost cause. If I come with you, I'm gonna die. I don't think my life right now is at a stage that it should be put to death because of this reason. Now, imagine how many opportunities are presented to us like this. Maybe it's not life and death, but there's a decision to be made. And we say, well, you know, I don't really see the tides turning right now. You know, the way I foresee things, I don't really see anything changing. So if I was to come and offer my support, nothing's going to change right now. When everyone else comes, then I'll come. Right? Reactive. But he tries to make an offer to the Imam. He says, okay, if I come, I'm not going to help you. But look, this is my horse. My horse here, Mulhiqa, is at your service by Allah. I've neither used it to pursue any enemy, and no enemy has pursued me while I was on this horse that I've been captured. So the horse has not been abused, and it's served me well. So take the horse. At least the horse will serve you as some good cause. The Imam says, now that you refuse our call to the truth, we don't need your horse either. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran also speaks about this. Surah Al-Kahf, verse 51. وَمَا كُنْتُ مُتَّخِذَ الْمُدَلِّينَ عَدُدًا We never took any of those misled people as our assistants. Imams never took people like this. They never afforded them the opportunity to enter. Once a person makes it clear they don't want to be there, Imam leaves. That's one person. Ubaydullah ibn Hur al-Jufi. Okay. Afforded the opportunity, said no. Another individual by the name of Amr ibn Qais. Amr ibn Qais is now narrated from Sheikh al-Saduq. Amr ibn Qais al-Masruqi. Him and his cousin also met with Imam Sina alayhi salatu wasalam in one of these stations, actually in the same station of the castle of Bani Masruq, Bani Muqatil, apologies. They come and they express their salams. The cousin of Amr ibn Qais makes an observation to the Imam. He looks to the beard of the Imam, he says that, your beard of yours, is that the natural color right now that is dark? Or have you colored it? The Imam says, no, us, Bani Hashim, our hair, our facial hair turns white very quickly. I've colored this. Okay. Then the Imam asks him, did you come to join me? And they respond, says, Amr responds, no, I'm an old man. One. Two, I have debts. And again, the analysis and assessment that I saw of what's happening, if I come with you, I'll probably be killed. And if I'm killed, what's going to happen? Who's going to pay my debts? So I'm responsible towards returning people's money. And he's trying to bring an excuse, you know, a religious excuse to say, like, if the right thing to do religiously now is to come back and the haqqun nas, make sure that that's really not lost. I should be here to do that. Okay. Imam says, what about your cousin? Cousin says, you know, I'm kind of in this, we're both in the same kind of boat. I also have debt as well. If I come, you know, I'm also gonna die. And the Imam says, then leave here. Leave here, don't be around here. Any person who's around this area, in this proximity, that even sees or experiences the shadow of our caravan, hears a call for our help and does not respond, then they will be thrown face first into the fire. Both of these stories shows what? The Imam lovingly takes initiative to approach people that even they are trying to escape, and lovingly provides them the opportunity in the presence of an Imam to make a change in their life and make a decision that will lead to eternal bliss and salvation. What is one person really going to do? Is one or two more people joining the Imam's army going to defeat armies of tens of thousands of people? No. That was never the point. The point is never to look and say that if we have enough people, then we'll be able to be victorious, we'll topple, we'll destroy, we'll dominate. It's never been the point. If the way we look at things is, when is the time where all of the experts are going to say that it looks like they're going to be victorious? That's never going to happen. The prophetic victories always came in times where the enemies were so confident and the mu'mineen initially were so cautious and so anxious. The Prophet says there's nothing to be afraid of. Because you're not fighting to dominate any other person. You're fighting for your own salvation. And your salvation is achieved through this action. If you're afforded this opportunity, you say no today, thinking that tomorrow there will be another one, you're fooling yourself. We say, okay, well, Mukhtar afterwards came. So whoever kind of missed the first, they're not the same. They are not the same. You cannot compare the two. So how many of these opportunities are afforded to us? And one after another, we keep saying, later, later, later. What happens if the later doesn't come? What happens if we're never afforded that opportunity? Contrast this now with another person, that the Imam came to him and he had a different response. The story we all know of Zuhayr ibn al-Qayn. Zuhayr ibn al-Qayn was also one of these people who were traveling when the Imam was traveling, and he was returning as well. The path of their journeys were similar, and they were kind of traveling in the same time period as well. And interestingly, as this is narrated from the story of Zuhayr ibn al-Qayn, Zuhayr says, we were traveling, and you know, we saw that the caravan of Husayn alayhi salatu wasalam was also there. And this is the language that's used now. This is as narrated by Abi Mikhnaf. It says, nothing was more like hateful to us, disliked to us, that we stop at the same place that the caravan of Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam stops. This is what he's saying, his impression was. We hated it. We hated having to stop with them. We hated that we had to travel with them. Not that they weren't together, but we hated that we were kind of traveling at the same time. Whenever the caravan of Hussein would stop, we would continue. So we didn't stop at the same place. Whenever they would continue, we would stop. Until finally one day, when we had no choice, we both stopped at the same place. And our tents were there. Now some of the narrators said the reason maybe why Zuhayr said that is because, you know, the caravan of Imam Hussein alayhi salam had the women, the children, the families. These were two, for example, men. It was a smaller family. Well, Zuhayr was with his wife as well. But you know, it was kind of a bigger... Imagine sometimes if you're traveling, of course, if you're married and you have children, maybe it's harder, but for the younger people who are, say, either not married, you know, single, or if they're married, they don't have kids. Imagine if you're traveling, you go to the airport, and you're trying to check in, and, you know, you don't even have any bags. You just have a check-in. You just have to go and get your boarding pass and leave. But there's like a caravan of 15 people, a big family. They have like 20 bags, and they all seem to be like stumbling against one after another. You look, there's a... No, it's going to take forever. Why can't I just kind of, you know, go around them and get on with my business? I'm not saying Zuhayr was thinking that, but it was something similar to that. In any case, they stop at the same place. They're sitting there eating food. You all know the story. Imam Hussein alayhi salam sends a messenger again. Zuhayr is shocked. What does he want with me? He called him. You all know that. His wife said, you know, the son of the Prophet's calling you. Are you not going to respond? Zuhayr goes, he hears, and he can't say no. And he accepts. And he comes and he tells the people that are there, listen, I've made a decision. a defining decision in my life. I know I'm going to go with Imam Hussein alayhi salatu wasalam, and I'm going to be martyred. Anyone who comes with me is going to suffer the same fate. And then he divorces his wife as well. He says, you know, I don't want any harm to come to you. You return to your family. These are two different people that the Imam lovingly comes to both of them. But each of them have a different sort of reaction to the Imam. So to conclude, inshallah, with the few minutes that we have, we'll recite a few minutes of musibah as well. For us as believing men and women, we have to make sure that we capitalize on the opportunities and the chances that we are given. In the Holy Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, Ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, istajibu lillah wa rasul. Istajibu lillah wa lirrasul, idha da'akum lima yuhyikum. Answer positively to Allah and His Messenger when they call you to that thing that brings life to you, that revives your life. وَعْلَمُ أَنَّ اللَّهَ يَحُولُ بَيْنَ الْمَرْءِ وَقَلْبِهِ. And know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala intervenes between man and his heart. If a person's intention is deep down in the heart, Allah will come and change a person's heart and change a person's mind. وَأَنَّهُ إِلَيْهِ تُحْشَرُونَ. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وعجل فرجهم لا حول ولا قوة إلا بالله العلي العظيم. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله. السلام عليك يا ابن رسول الله. السلام عليك يا ابن أمير المؤمنين وابن سيد الوسيم. السلام على ولي الله وحبيبه. السلام على خليل الله ونجيبه. السلام على سفي الله وابن سفيه. السلام على الحسين المظلوم الشهيد. السلام على عسير الكربات وقتيل العبرات. When the caravan of Abu Abdullah al-Hussein has almost concluded their journey from Medina back to Medina, last night we recited the sermon of Zainul Abidin alayhi salatu wassalam. When the caravan returns to Medina, of those of the Ahlul Bayt that were remaining to return to the city of their grandfather Rasulullah, each of them had to grieve their own way, and each of them recited their emotions in their own words and in lines of poetry. It is recorded in some of the narrations that when the Ahlul Bayt were arriving to Medina, that Umm Kulthum recited a number of lines of poetry, speaking her mind, speaking the state of her heart, speaking to the city of Medina, speaking to all of the sorrow and grief and strife that they endured. She recites, Medina tajaddina la taqbalina fabil hasarati wal ahzani ji'na. O Medina of our grandfather, do not accept us because we have returned with grief and sorrow and being pained and distress. Ala fa'akhbir Rasulallah anna bi anna qad fuji'na fi abina. O city of Medina, inform the Holy Prophet that we are shocked for the loss of our father's disappearance. وَأَنَّ رِجَالَنَا بِالطَّفِّ سَرْعَى بِلَا رُؤُسٍ وَغَذَّ بَحُوا الْبَرِينَ Inform the Holy Prophet that the bodies of our men are still at the land of Taf and Karbala, that their heads were separated and the enemies have slaughtered our children. وأخبر جدنا أننا أسرنا وبعد الأسر يا جدا سبينا. And communicate with the Holy Prophet, our grandfather, that we were taken captive and driven like prisoners and were humiliated. ورحتك يا رسول الله يضحو عريا بالطفوف مسلبينا. O Rasul Allah, the bodies of your family are placed uncovered. Their goods have been looted. وَقَدْ ذَبَحُوا الْحُسَيْنَ وَلَمْ يُرَاعُوا جَنَابَكَ يَا رَسُولَ اللَّهِ فِيْنَا. These enemies attacked Hussein and slaughtered him. They did not consider us exclusively as your special reference in your family. فَلَوْ نَذَرَتْ عُيُونُكَ لِلْأُسَارَى عَلَى أَقْطَامِ الْجِمَالِ مُحَمِّلِينَ. Perhaps, O Holy Prophet, if you observed us as hostages that were ill-treated, we were forced to sit on the bare backs of the camels. رَسُولَ اللَّهِ بَعْدَ السَّوْنِ السَّارَتْ عُيُونُ النَّاسِ نَاذِرَةً إِلَيْنَا. O our grandfather, after our strict observations of hijab, the haunted eyes of the people stared at us without hesitation. وكنت تحوطنا حتى تولت عيونك ثارت الأعداء علينا. You have protected us greatly, but as soon as you have closed your eyes, the enemies from your nation attacked us. أفاطم لو نظرت إلى السبايا بناتك في البلاد مشتتينا. O Fatima, perhaps if you could observe your imprisoned daughters who were pulled from city to city and town to town uncovered. أفاطم لو نظرت إلى الحيارة أو لو أبصرت زينا العابدين. O Fatima, perhaps if you had watched your children in distress, perhaps if you had observed the condition of Zainul Abidin. أفاطم لو رأيتنا سهارا ومن سهر الليالي قد عمينا. O Fatima, perhaps if you had watched how we spent the nights without sleep and ultimately led to our blindness. مدينة جدنا لا تقبلينا. O Medina of our grandfather, do not accept us. فبالحسرات والأحزان جئنا. For we have come back along with much sorrow and much grief. خرجنا منك بالأهلين جمعا رجعنا لا رجال ولا بنينا. When we left you, O Medina, our house was full of men and companions. And now when we have returned, neither men nor children can be seen. وَكُنَّا فِي الْخُرُوجِ بِجَمْعِ شَمْلٍ وَجَعْنَا حَاسِرِينَ مُسَلَّبِينَ. At the time of our departure, O Medina, our whole group and jama'ah was with us. Now that we come back, we are bareheaded and looted. وَكُنَّا فِي أَمَانِ اللَّهِ جَهْرًا رَجَعْنَا بِالطَّعِيَاتِ خَائِفِينَ. When we left you, O Medina, we were openly under the protection of Allah. And today as we return without protection but with fear. وَمَوْلَانَ الْحُسَيْنُ لَنَا أَنِيسٌ. And at that time, our Mawla, our Master Hussein, was our protector and helper. وَرَجَعْنَا وَالْحُسَيْنُ بِهِ رَهِينَا. Today we have returned and handed him to the land of Karbala. فَنَحْنُ الضَّائِعَاتُ بِلَا كَفِيلٍ وَنَحْنُ النَّاجِحَاتُ عَلَىٰ أَخِينَا. Today we are the ones affected who have no guardian, and we are lamenting upon our brother Hussein. وَنَحْنُ بَنَاتُ يَاسِينَ وَطَاهَا وَنَحْنُ الْبَاكِيَاتُ عَلَىٰ أَبِينَا. O Medina, we are the daughters of Yasin and Taha. Oh, Medina, we are weeping upon our father and our brothers who were martyred.
ونحن الطاهرات بلا خفاء ونحن المخلصون المصطفون.
There is no doubt we are the chosen and purified and pious ladies.
We are Allah's sincere and selected ones, dignified and sacred.
ونحن الصابرات على البلايا ونحن الصادقون الناصحون.
We are the patient ones upon these calamities. We are the true and the affectionate ones.
ألا يا جدنا قتلوا حسين.
Oh, our grandfather, our enemies murdered Hussein.
ولم يرعوا جناب الله فينا.
And they cared not for Allah's order regarding us.
ألا يا جدنا بلغت عدانا مناها واشتفى الأعداء فينا.
Oh, our grandfather, the enemies achieved their wish and became cold-blooded after torturing us.
لقد هتكوا النساء وحملوها على الأقطاب قهرا أجمعينا.
The women were disregarded, disgraced and humiliated, and they were all degraded by the parade upon the camels.
وزينب أخرجوها من خباها وفاطم والهن تبدل أنينا.
Hijab of Zainab was snatched from her head. Fatima was crying.
سكينتو تشتكي من حر وجد تنادي الغوث رب العالمين.
Due to the grief of departure of Aga Hussein,
Sakina recalled her father again and again and said, Oh Allah, help us and help us.
وزين العابدين بقيد ذل ورامو قتلته أهل الخؤونة.
And Zain al-Abidin was arrested and chained and humiliated.
Enemies intended to kill him time after time.
فبعدهم على الدنيا تراب.
O Medina, after all that said, after their martyrdom, after what befell us, dust upon this world, there is no reason to live now.
فكأس الموت فيها قد سقينا.
There is no charm in this wicked world, for we have drunk a cup of poison in this journey.
وهذه قصتي مع شرح حالي.
ألا يا سامعون أبكوا علينا.
This is our detailed story and our detailed account.
O listener of our grief, lament upon us and cry upon us.
Hussein, 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 Hussein.
على لعنة الله على القوم الظالمين وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. اللهم إنا نسألك وندعوك باسمك العظيم العظم العز الأجل الأكرم إلهي بحق الحسين. يا الله 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 يا رحمن يا رحيم يا مقلب القلوب ثبت قلوبنا على دينك واكفنا يا قاضي الحاجات ويا كافي المهمات إنك مجيب الدعوات إنك على كل شيء قدير. اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج اللهم عجل لوليك الفرج والعافية والنصر وجعلنا من خير أنصاره وعوانه ومستشهدين بين يديه. يا الله, we ask you on a night like this, in commemorating Abu Abdullah al-Husayn, his companions, and his beloved family that returned to Medina, Ya Allah, we ask you to hasten the reappearance of our Imam. Ya Allah, we ask you to make us steadfast and firm in our religion. Ya Allah, we ask you to guide us and to guide our children. Ya Allah, we ask you to bring us speedy recovery and good health to all of those who are ill. Ya Allah, we ask you to bless, forgive, and to unite all of those who have passed from our loved ones, from this community, from all the believing men and women with the Ahlul Bayt on a night like this. Specifically, there has been request to make Fatiha and Dua for the Marhumin of the sponsors of tonight's program. Sayyid Abdul Hassan Naqvi, Ibn Mir Asadullah Khan Naqvi, Marzia Hassan Naqvi, Bint Taqi Hussein Razvi, Mir Askar Ali Razvi, Ibn Mir Hassan Ali Razvi,
Razia Askar Ali bint Taqi Hussein Razbi. All of the sponsors who have sponsored the Majalis of Abu Abdullah Hussein, this is really what we look forward to. This is the only thing that we can look to after we're put in our graves to come to our aid. Ya Allah, we ask you on a night like this to bless us, what we heard, to allow us to leave this majlis better than we were, inshallah. Salawat ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Allahumma salli ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad wa ajal farajah.